Hello, this is a joint production between the Grand Valley State Veterans History Program, WKTV Voices, and the USS Silversides Museum. My name is Koty Leroy-Rollins, and I'm here with Donald Goodman of Muskegon, Michigan. So let's start off early, I guess. Your childhood, what made you sort of want to join the military?
Well, I not only remember Pearl Harbor, I remember when Hitler invaded Poland, but I didn't want to join then. I was only 6 years old then. But as far as, I grew up in World War II, and I had an uncle who went in, but even then I didn't have any enormous desire to go in. I went to school to graduate. Oh, if I can wander from that for a minute, I'm gonna.
That's okay, go ahead.
I'm going to say my overall impression in the Army, when I go see people now and I wear my shirt or I wear the hat and they say, thank you for your service. I want to say, thank you for your Army. Because the Army did far more for me than I ever did for it. And when I joined, why did I join? You know, I'm not even sure why I joined. The Korean War started in summer of 1950. I graduated from high school in 1949, and I went on to Navy Pier, which was the University of Illinois Chicago branch.
Okay.
And I was there. That was supposed to be a two-year college. I actually got 3 years out of it. In the summer, I was working in a chemical factory, in the control lab of the chemical factory. Otherwise, I hadn't been working. I'd been working since I was about 12. So I was going to finish. I was ready to join the Air Force when I was just ready to turn 1950. And I'd gone there to the Air Force, signed the papers, ready to leave the next week, got appendicitis. They took out the appendicitis and the appendix, and then the Air Force came and said, where's the little Donnie? I said, well, just had the appendix. Well, we don't want him for 6 months. I said, okay. So I thought, might as well go for another semester. Amazingly, just then in January, on my birthday, I met this cute little gal. And I said, you know, I can't go in the military. I might as well finish up my third year. And in the meantime, this was in Chicago Heights, Illinois. And she was from Chicago. So we dated. And through that winter, that was the first part of 1952. And I got to thinking, you know, Air Force is 4 years, the Army's only two. So I walked into the Army, and it wasn't hard for them to talk me into it. So I joined, left. And then in June, the Air Force came and knocked on my door again, and my mother was there, and they said, you know, does Donnie want to come out and play? And well, no, she said, he's in the Army. So I said, well, we're not going to go get him. As far as why did I join, I think I joined because, well, for one thing, I didn't want to waste any more money for college. Was my money, it was my dad's money, but also because everybody's gone. My mother said, do you want to have a going away party? I said, who would come? Everybody I know, Skaronski's in the Air Force, Van Buskirk's in the Army, Otto Bomberg is in the Air Force. I forget, everybody I could name was gone. And they either dodged the draft by enlisting in something or else they were drafted. So I went in.
Okay. So.
So I went in and to Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri. And that's where I went through basic training. I said in the beginning that I owe the Army much more than anybody owes me. If you went through my high school yearbook, the end of the high school, after 4 years and see, what did I do? Was I on a football team? Well, not likely. Was I on basketball? No. In fact, the only thing behind my name, after 4 years. I belonged to the Audubon Club, and I wrote for the college, or for the high school newspaper. If you looked at what they did when I finished 40 years of teaching, I had been chief negotiator, contract negotiator for year after year after year for two different schools, for a public school system and for the college. I was grievance chairman over and over. They elected me or appointed whatever they did, the distinguished faculty. And as a matter of fact, in 75 years of college, they had only bestowed that on like six other people. I think I was number seven, Jack Rice was number eight. So, why? Because the Army. They helped me find who I was. And they did it, well, the way they usually do things. Mm. When I got in, beginning, for some reason I had it in my mind, I'm gonna teach you people how to soldier, although I didn't, I knew how to shoot a rifle, that's all. And I thought, I am gonna be the best soldier. At the end of 16 weeks of basic, with 8 weeks infantry and 8 weeks engineering, the training sergeants picked out four trainees to compete for best training. I had no idea they were looking at me. So there I was, but I never made better than four. So I thought later, I really ought to have a pin made that says, I'm number four. But out of 250, that wasn't bad.
That's pretty high.
So there's one thing that was surprised, that if you look at the pictures, if you find pictures of our outfits, this is 1952, they look totally different from anything 4 years before or in World War II, because when Truman took over, Truman became president in 1945, April, when FDR died. And in 1948, he integrated the armies, all of the armed forces. So you see pictures of all these trainees together in the barracks, scrubbing down and doing all that, and there's blacks all over the place. They were colored in those days. But when I got on permanent cadre as a company clerk, we had some strains here and there with some of the Southerners. I ain't taking a shower with him, or I ain't sleeping next to him. You want to bet? So some of them had a hard bringing up to get used to that. Anyway, I am in basic training. There was one night kind of stuck, and it does stick in my mind. And I can't imagine how some of these guys underwent real combat. In this basic training thing, what we did was it was supposed to be a commando raid. And we were supposed to cross the Big Piney and take a hill. Well, we got eight blanks in our M1s. And we were supposed to be quietly paddling these boats that held about a dozen guys across the river, and then sneak up the hillside and not bother it. Well, of course, the first boat made enough noise that the machine guns up on top were going full blast by the time we got there. And you were supposed to push this boat. It held about 10 people, 10 guys. Push it out into the water and then pile in and paddle across. We had no training in paddling. There was no instruction on paddling at all. We were supposed to get there, land the boat. They had one person in charge, pilot in charge of the boat, just steered, I guess. And he was gonna stay with the boat, and we were supposed to run up this hill and shoot eight shots to show our good intentions, and then turn around and run back and get in the same boat. Well, you got in any boat you could after that. To make it more realistic, they were using quarter pound blocks of nitrous starch, and they were capped the fuse, and fuses work well even under the water. This is like probably has about the same speed as dynamite. I don't know, maybe 13,000 feet per second, something. Anyway, it was not as strong. Anyway, these were little blocks. They looked like a stick of butter. Hmm. And they were out there in the water and go boom, whoosh, and boom, whoosh, all around, and with the machine guns up there, and all the noise. And so we heard boom, whoosh, boom, whoosh, and then we heard boom. And we thought, what was that? Well, it seemed the boat in front of us was supposed to cross in front of us. The guys had hauled it out into the water, piled in, but they piled in too soon, and it went down and dragged on the river bottom. And so half of them jumped out, tried to pull it. The sergeant who was running these things and throwing the nitrous starch in the water, he grabbed them and pulled them, and they turned the boat so it was all cockababy. Yeah, that's what it sounded like. Anyway, I didn't know we had sound effects there. They got turned around and they're paddling. Some are paddling this side and that side, and I think some were paddling in the air. And they twisted around and went right over one of those charges.
Oh, no.
So instead of boom, whoosh, and boom, because it blew the bottom out. And there they are screaming, because I imagine some of them had broken legs by that time. And the boat is there. We can see it, not that far ahead of us. Floating, twisting around, and they're screaming because they're hurt, and some of them are still paddling, and the boat is sinking because it's got a big hole blown in it. And I just remember that the insanity. Oh, I know, we're going to stop and help them, and the sergeant is yelling to us, "You're on a mission, you don't stop, you're on a mission." The whole insanity of the reality of the high explosives and the reality of these guys hurt, and the insanity of the shots, blanks, it's stuck in my mind. I still think of it. I can't imagine what these guys who've been through real combat are like, because that's the one night in basic training I remember.
And they didn't.
So, we got back. We went up and shot our eight, da 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 da, and then came back. And when we got back, there was an officer standing on top of some platform, and he was saying, "We have never had an accident in this operation before." But people did get hurt. Yeah. And one thing that ticked me off about the records of the Korean War, they tell you, and I don't want to downplay Vietnam. Vietnam, they said they had killed 58,000. In the Korean War, they're divided. They're still arguing about how many got killed in accidents and maneuvers. They say, yeah, 36,000 got killed in Korea. But there's arguments about whether there was actually 18,000 killed in maneuvers. I, as company clerk, I can't remember ever filling out a death certificate. I sent a lot of people to the hospital, most of them with pneumonia. But I ran into a couple of other accidents when I was company clerk. They bring people in. Oh my God. A friend of ours had the craziest kind of accident imaginable. He must have been one of the last people who suffered from a poison gas. So what had happened was this. Ellsworth was his name, great guy. He lived later on when Betty and I were living on the post. I got married in the Army. I think his trailer was right down from ours. Anyway, poor Dan Ellsworth. He'd been through Korea, and he had a number of medals. He wanted to make the Army career. Fine. Then he went to ski troops, learned to ski, and then they shipped him to Fort Leonard, but God knows why. And he wanted to be in the training part. He wanted to teach. And they put him on CB, chemical, biological, and radiological training. Okay, we had to go, besides going through the gas chamber, the tear gas chamber, which everybody remembers real well, they also took the trainees and ran them through light concentrations of other poison gas.
Oh, wow.
And I think a Phosgene and Mustard, and I don't know what other one. Okay, his job was to set one of these off. He had a tube of, and I think it was Phosgene, I'm not sure. And then he had two blasting caps taped to it, and they were wired to each other. And then the long wires, and I think they were maybe 15 feet long, and he was supposed to put that out there where they set it off, and as soon as, while the stuff was still in the air, they'd run these trainees through this so they could get, so they could smell the poison gas and see what it was like. He pulled the shunts on the caps. The I don't know, you know anything about explosives? They had
not much.
Okay, they got the blasting, got a blasting cap, looks like about a half of a wooden pencil, and it's got petin in it, that's a high explosive. And when you, and it's got two wires, and of course, wired, when electricity comes, it'll spark and set off the petin. Yeah. And so you should never pull that shunt until you're just about ready. Well, he was in a hurry, and he was carrying this tube of poison gas with two blasting caps on. Fortunately, he wasn't pinching it. He was just holding it lightly. He pulled the shunt, and he walked across the field and must have picked up static electricity, because all of a sudden, bam, and there he is with his fingers blown back and flopping. And he squatted down then and actually sat on his heel, which was smeared with mustard gas that had been there from whatever the last one was. Oh, yeah. So he went into the hospital as a victim of poison gas, and they had to fix try and save his fingers, which they did, and then take care of this thing back here. And every lieutenant around would come there and say, half-mast soldier, I want to see that. I've never seen a mustard gas blister. So I have to pull his skivvies down, and so I talked to him. I went to visit him. I sat embarrassed. And said, nah. He said, it could be, but I'd like to shove my butt in the face of those damned officers. He said, I'm hoping for a major, but he never got me.
Make the best out of a bad situation.
I never did know what happened, because I got graduated. Yeah, I got discharged.
So you were in Fort Leonard Wood from what dates?
From June 1952 to June 1954, and after basic, they sent me to Company C6 Quartermaster at the time, because they had an opening there as a company clerk. Their company clerk had been promoted to first sergeant, and then we got another first sergeant. What happens? I don't know if you've talked to anybody in a training outfit, but by the time you get through with most training outfits, the way they change personnel so fast, you should really read Catch 22. Because if you read Catch 22, you find that the one who's running the entire war is PFC Wintergreen. And so many of our outfits were run by the PA, by the clerk, the company clerk, and the supply sergeant. And that's what happened. You wound up, even if you only had one stripe, you wound up taking on jobs, answering questions, filling out forms, signing forms, and in effect,
running it.
I looked at I had a really good company commander at first then, and he got transferred to someplace else. And I can't remember who followed up, but he had brought in this big World War II hero who was one nasty soul. God, he was mean. And you could see he had ghost stripes. In other words, he'd been sergeant at one time, and he was no more. So he got busted for something, and Captain Gullickson got him another stripe, so he's there. We always call him sergeant. He gave me stories of World War II, like, I don't want this guy on my side, but I don't want him on the other side either. And so he'd come in drunk, really drunk, and the and beat up the troops, beat up the trainees. We got 200, when I got assigned there as company clerk, we had, we get 250 civilians in every 8 weeks and run them through, teach them infantry basics and how to salute and march and so on. And, then the next, then we get, they'd be gone and we'd have the next bunch the next day. So I was processing a lot of that stuff. Okay. But I remember this one sergeant, our first sergeant, and he was standing in front of me, just like, you're there, I was doing whatever, and he says, and I look at him, and he said, I hear you're gonna testify against me at my court-martial. Those are my orders, Sergeant. And he knew where, and he said, make it good, I wanna get out of this fucking army any way I can. Well, I didn't have to tell him much. I could testify to his being AWOL. I could have covered up the AWOL. I'd done that with people before, but he didn't want that. I didn't have to say anything. The trainees that testified against him were enough. He got a less than honorable discharge, and away he went. And he was replaced by a friend of mine who was full-time pistol shooter. He was on I don't know how many teams, and he was always gone. So, company clerk takes over his job. Then the next, then he was transferred someplace else. I forget who came in after he did. And then, someplace in there, as I say, we had the army was, all of the colored troop organizations were dissolved. They were spread out. Yeah. Reassigned, and we got this one sergeant who had been, shoot, he might have been in World War II, I don't know, anyway, he was a full sergeant, and he came in, but he didn't, Louis Gonzalez was the supply sergeant, and what he and I wanted was a company commander who just let us do things, let us take care of things, and a first sergeant, it didn't matter, that didn't get into our way because we had a nice running.
Yeah, it was a smooth operation.
Yeah, it was going well. And there was Sergeant, I don't want to slip and tell his name, let me call him Jones. So Louis Gonzalez was a supply sergeant, he and I were.
Yeah.
And he said, when in the middle of summer, he said, do you know what Jones is? Do you know where Jones is? I said, no, I haven't seen him. I mean, they come and go and come and go. And he said, he's over there in the captain's office, sitting behind the stove, it's a coal stove, but it's summer. So, and he's just sitting there with his hands folded. And he's looking up like that. Here, and that's what he's doing for a couple of hours at a time. I said, well, what do you think? He said, well, you can talk to Cunningham, who was next door in battalion. And he said, you know, what are you going to do, call up the regiment and say, I think my first sergeant's crazy. Do you have any idea how many clerks think their first sergeant's crazy? And what's it gonna, is he bothering you? No, we'll leave him then. I thought, what the heck? He doesn't need anything. He'd be gone for hours, and then he'd come back. He never did do so, but one time, this was one of the scariest nights I had. He went on leave to East St. Louis and came back with a social disease. After a while, he discovered he had, and so he went in to the medics and talked to them. While he was there, he was explaining to the doctor exactly how the world operated, instead of how you think it is. And so they just kind of kept him. And the next thing we know, well, we're getting orders that he's being transferred to some hospital out east, and we should box up his Foot Locker stuff, and they'd come and store it someplace. I said, what about his car? Because there were a number of times on Monday morning when I'd round up a Jeep and he couldn't remember where he'd left his car. And he'd have parked it, God knows, out in some rain someplace, and Leonard Wood's a big place. And how he made it back, I don't know, or where he spent it, but he'd be there on Monday morning, couldn't find his car, so we weren't looking. So I asked, what about his car? And they said, I don't know, so somebody found it out there in the sticks. And I called the motor pool and said, winter was coming. I said, I don't know what shape this thing is, got no business being there, so you better tow it in and take it to the motor pool and store it. They had storage.
Yeah.
So, but that's the end of it. I checked into that. And it was months later, I went to the movies, and I came bouncing back in, and the CQ, I was supposed to appoint people to be CQ, you know, charge of quarters at night to be supposedly answer the one phone we had in the company.
Yeah.
And he was sitting back there, and he had this funny look on his face, and I came up, and I thought, what? And I could see from his eyes, and he looked over. Oh, well, Sergeant Jones, there he was, full uniform, medals, all that. How are you doing? Well, what do you say? You know,
yeah.
You were crazy. Did they fix that or what? You know,
that feels like not a very good opening line.
Way to
you
go.
Were crazy. Did they fix that?
I said,
oh. Did you escape?
Said you back?
Yeah.
But we got no paperwork. He wasn't sent back to us because by then we had a different first sergeant who was well into booze. And he was just as useless as anybody else, which was fine, as far as we're concerned. So, good to see you. And he said, Goodman, you know what happened to my car? And I said, yeah, we finally found it out there. And he said, where is it? I said, it's in storage. We bought it. And he said, I forget the order anyway. He asked me, what'd you do? I said, we had it towed back. He said, how did you do that? Wasn't it locked up? And I said, yeah, I had to break a window, broke a little wing, and unlocked it and had it towed away. And then I had him drain the radiator and the battery, and it was there. He said, who broke the window? But I broke it because I didn't, I'm not going to lie. Stood up and he patted me on the shoulder. You're a good man, Goodman. And he walked out the door.
What a crazy individual. I guess you got
never knew what happened to him. We had no paperwork, no way for me to check up on anything. Why should I check on his car? But that was one of the weirdest. Anyway, his successor was, and we had a first lieutenant who was just screwed up one way or another. I got the phone call, and the phone said, you're due for prisoner chase. The company C. Okay, we need a name. But I'm tired of being in here anyway. I said, I was corporal by then, Donald J. Goodman, RA-1641-5609, okay. And didn't think any more about it, and then got the orders from him. And the company commander, the lieutenant there, a couple of weeks, he said, Goodman, you're on prisoner chase. I said, geez, how did that happen? Must have been random or something. He said, okay, so I was assigned, and I can't remember, I keep trying to remember this. Memory doesn't, we'll call it. If there were three of us and we had to pick up five prisoners, or there were five of us and we had to pick up seven prisoners, I'm pretty sure it was just three of us that what we had to do was take train and wear a Class B uniform, which was all dress, tie, a whole bit, but combat boots. And of course, we had to pick up pistols. We had to pick up our 45 Colts. Anyway, so we went to, I didn't know these other guys, and two of us were corporals. The other one, I forget. So we got up there, and I had already been read the orders for a prisoner chase for the same sort of thing. Go to Sheridan, pick up your prisoners, handcuff them, bring them back through Chicago, and deliver them such and such. Take 2 days. Okay. So we got to check out our pistols and the ordnance. You guys are all qualified with a 45, aren't you? No, nobody was. Said, anybody ever shoot a 45? I said, yeah, I've shot the target. Okay, you're in charge. That's good. I like that because I had plans. And so we got our pistols. You can't put the clip in until you get your prisoner. But we had got our pistols and our handcuffs, and we're off. And
must be a boat.
No, we never had those down at Fort Lambert. We got up, and I had all the chits and all for meals and the orders and the whole bit. And my wife didn't like me to tell the story, but I'll tell them. So we were on the train going from St. Louis up to Chicago. And I said, how'd you guys, I know they expected us at Sheridan, how'd you guys like to spend the night in Chicago? And I said, can we do that? And I said, well, I'm in charge. I said, you can. Never give a guy two stripes. God knows what he'll do with the power. We got there into Chicago to the Randolph Street station. And I said, we'll have to find place for you to stay, and you got to pay for it. Okay. So in those days, they had a monstrous Chicago telephone directory, but the truth was, for a guy in uniform, all he had to do was ask any cop, hey, is there a motel I can stay at here? Otherwise, so they decided, they asked the cop, and they went to the YMCA. Said, I'm not staying there. Okay. I said, I'll meet you tomorrow morning, 7 o'clock at the Randolph Street station. We'll take that up to Sheridan, pick up our prisoners, bring them back, walk them through the loop, and change stations. We had to walk from Randolph Street station to the Union station. Yeah. And then catch that to St. Louis. So I said, we got to do something with your pistols. Why don't you check? They probably have a safe there at the Y. Why don't you just check them in there? Whatever you do, don't get arrested. Whatever you do, don't get drunk. No drinking. Okay, fine. They said, where are you going? I said, oh, I know where I'm going. So, 9:40, so I left them there and said, I'll pray that they wouldn't get drunk or arrested or into trouble there in Chicago. While I took the IC down to 63rd Street, I think, and then took a trolley down to 85th, because I was going to 914 West 85th Street, where this cute little gal that I'd married 2 months, 2 months before was waiting. Mind you, this is long before there's any cell phone. So everything we had arranged, we'd done by writing or by plain telephone. So that's where I headed, walking through Chicago with my big pistol on my hip and taking the, and so stayed there. That was better than the Y. Got up in the morning and cleaned up and took the trolley and took the IC train back there and prayed that these guys would meet me at the Randolph Street station.
Did they get there?
They were there, bright and chipper. I said, did you have a good time? Oh, yeah. I said, what'd you do? I said, we went to the movies. Okay. I said, where'd you eat? Wimpy's? You got this Chicago cuisine in front of you, and you eat at Wimpy's. Yeah, it was better than the mess hall. So we went and picked up our five prisoners. Hooked two of them together, and then I picked the biggest guard I had and fastened him to the other oddball. And we'd been warned, don't let them, the last prisoner chases, freight chasers lost one. Want to lose one because, we don't, because we got our old handcuffs there. I don't want to be wearing them. So we got them back just fine. We got the eye when we walked down through the loop from station to station. But, it was kind of fun.
So what were you getting these prisoners for?
I don't know. I don't remember what they were. I doubt that they were desperate murdering criminals, mass murders. My guess is they were guys who got homesick and ran away to home. And then they'd let them, and MPs would let them sit there for 30 days. Oh, and if they still had their uniform, then they charged them with AWOL. If they destroyed their uniform, desertion. And this was wartime. You didn't want to be charged with desertion.
Yeah.
So they were probably headed for Korea after they finished. They'd go, they'd finish basic training under the gun. We had a number of guys that went through our basic training outfit with guards right behind them. And I'm sure they got shipped off to Korea. So I can't believe that these guys were anybody that was that dangerous. I don't remember.
So these were like army guys that
They were just
away.
Army guys. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, they were just trainees.
I didn't know if you were just like picking up random prisoners to draft into the army or...
No, they'd been in, and I'm sure they just got homesick and ran away home. And so the MPs came and knocked on their door and said, can Bobby come out and play? And
then they, made
then they took
him
to Sheridan. And so they never asked us at Sheridan where we'd spent the night before. I was glad of that.
It's probably a good thing.
But the Army did that for me. I belonged to the Audubon Club in high school. But I was, they had taught me, this is your mission, that one awful night that blew things up. And if you got a job to do, you do it. And so I had in mind that I had a job to do.
So,
and it's too late to court-martial now.
There you go. You mind if I ask a few questions?
No,
about
go
basic?
Ahead. I'm sorry. I knew I'd ramble.
No, it's okay. It's interesting stuff. I never even knew he did that. But so one thing that was really sort of outlined in my historical background and classes on this is that the training for Korea and Vietnam, like the basic training, had nothing to do with what the combat was actually like there.
I will tell you, I think now looking back over it, when we had cities and training and shoot 'em up training in towns and villages, there were no hooches there. They didn't teach, we weren't shooting up Korean hooches. Those were European towns that we were, I think they were preparing us to fight Europe.
Mm-hmm.
In Europe, that was what, and our chance, I don't know how much you're going to do about editing this, but besides chant, when we learned to march, GI beans and GI gravy, GI wish I'd known. Anyway, and it was up to perform. You had a good home and you left. You're right, you wouldn't go back if you could. You're wrong, so on. If I die in a combat zone, box me up and ship me home. Sound off, 1, 2, sound off, 3, 4. And then it was, if I die in a Russian front, bury me with a Russian cunt. Sound off, 1, 2, sound off. That didn't sound like Korea. It looked to me, and we saw films of the Russians in World War II, and we knew about that little Tommy gun, that little burp gun they had with a drum and a ventilated barrel, and their Wasson-Gant rifles. So I think we were gearing up to go to war with Russia at that time in 52. I didn't think about it at the time, but
oh yeah,
they were.
That's what they were training you for, was if the Soviets attacked.
I think it must have been. An interesting thing, well, I did graduate. My oldest son was born the day I was discharged, and if she hadn't come through with that, they wouldn't have let her in the base hospital. I don't know what we would have done, but took her in, and so she was. I was getting processed out of the Army. She was over in the base hospital, and I came back from processing, another Sergeant Jones, let's say, this was the boozer, and he said, oh, Goodman, your wife had a baby. I said, what'd she have? I don't know, babies are babies. What the hell?
That's not
so
how that
I scooted off to the hospital. See, my son, my oldest son, we stayed there. I think we just stayed there a week. And then my mother came to, we were living in a 28-foot trailer at the time. It was an Army trailer, you know. And I'd managed to get one in January of 54. Maybe it was February. And so we lived there until June, and then packed up and headed for back home to Chicago Heights, where I found my folks had sold their house and they were building another one, and we were planning, three of us planning to stay there. Their house, so it was an interesting time right after that. I know what I wanted to tell you. Aside from doing, I became a teacher. At that time, teachers, especially men teachers, were held in high esteem. It's not like today. Today, they just treat them like dirt. But in those days, God, that makes me sound old. In those days, in the 50s when I started, and the 60s, even into the 70s, if you saw a guy teaching in an elementary school or high school, and he wasn't real old, he probably was a vet. And he probably would not put up with a whole lot of crap from anybody. they were guys who did. And later on, when Jack Rice and I wrote, 30 years later, 1990s, we were talking to the vets who had come in on the GI Bill from World War II and stuff. Were they a nutty bunch. And they were so gutsy. The school they were in was that old Hackley building that looks like a castle. And they had one teacher who, the teachers didn't know how to handle these guys either. Mackerel, but you've got these 17-year-olds in with these guys who've been 50 bombing missions over Germany and whatever else they'd been through, they didn't know how to handle them. And this one, they told me about this one teacher, an English teacher, she hated, it was the second floor, she hated the pigeons to gather at the top of the window. So she had some kind of long pole that, I guess to open and unlock the window. Anyway, she'd get up there and tap the window and chase them away. So she had some other peculiar thing. So they got up there, second floor, got out one window, crept along the windowsill, unscrewed the screws that held that window up, and then went back down. And the next day when she went tap, the whole window went down, and she about had a heart attack. They did worse than that. They decided there in the middle of Skagen, there was big talk they were going to change, they were going to move the community, it wasn't even community college, it was a junior college. They were going to move it out to where it is now, over the banks of Four Mile Creek. And a couple of them who were apparently old engineers, the Army engineers, you know what, they don't have a bridge there. No, don't have a bridge. So a couple of them, I can imagine, took a few six-packs to get them into this. Well, bring them a bridge. Okay, where are we gonna, we're not gonna build one. Well, no, just find one, we'll move it.
They stole the bridge?
Okay, so that was, the bridge they picked was not, it was just a regular city street that had a two-lane, and it was not far from where the old farmer's market in Skagen is now. I've driven over that bridge. So they prepared ahead of time. They spent weeks squirting oil of WD-40 or whatever they had then on the bolts and planning with their, so this was the big night. They were gonna, I bet they were well oiled, that took not only the bridge, but them too. They had a flatbed truck, they had a crane, and they were under there unscrewing, and they heard the train come. So the guy underneath figures, this is a steam engine, he's about to become barbecued. and barbecued by bridge. So he's yelling, take me up, take me up. And they're down there playing the game. What's the password? And finally they helped him up and decided, you know, this isn't the night to move the bridge. So the way they went and took the truck back to wherever it had been and took the crane back wherever they got it, and wherever they got the tools. But as I started as a teacher in 1956, we were treated really well. People were on our side, and nobody tried this crap that these teachers are undergoing now, where you got a bunch of checklists, you got somebody come in and decide what good teachers do and what good teaching is, and these are guys who couldn't teach a puppy to poop on a paper, and they're running the schools.
Yeah. So what grade were you teaching?
Oh, I taught sixth grade for 13 years in a ghetto school. I never had less than 36 kids. Their average reading level was 4, but I didn't have discipline problems. Partly because I never sent a kid to the principal. I didn't have to. On the other hand, they didn't come in and tell me what I could do and couldn't do. I never had a charge leveled against me. And I show people pictures of my last sixth grade class. Mind you, these are all black kids, so if you wonder about that. There's a picture of them, gonna take them on a field trip to Grand Rapids Museum. So I had to do the arrangement. I got the bus figured out. These kids are dressed up really nice, like it's Sunday, and I was taking their picture, and they don't look like they're beat up, or they don't look like they don't look like they're wild either. They're just kids. And people look at the picture and say, but I had the one kid. I can't make up a name for her. Her name is Teresa. Anyway, she was always a bit of a devil and got into things. One time we were playing cage ball. I don't know, you know what cage ball is? Nope. You do crab running and you have this gigantic ball and you kick it with your feet. You can't have shoes on. And there's this, it's kind of like soccer. If anybody makes a point, it's a miracle.
Yeah.
And they're kicking it back and forth. And there was the backstop for the basket. They crank it up. They're not going to, because it uses gym for everything. The way you crank it up is there is a cast iron crank. Okay. You've got this big box on the wall, and that's what you put that thing into and turn it, and it winds up cranking the thing up and down. All right, what do you do with a cast iron thing? The custodians put it on top. Fine. So I was standing under it, doing whatever refereeing you can do in this melee, and all of a sudden, wham, and I feel this thing, and it all but knocked me out, and I could feel blood. I sat down. And I could feel the blood up there. But the kids are, it's dead silent. And my God, what am I gonna do here? So I gotta get somebody in here to take the class, and the principal was there. So I did go down there, and I said, you gotta take over the class. She said, what do you want me to do? I said, give them spelling, tell them to write the words down 10 times, whatever, take them back to the room, because that's all they had left in time.
Yeah.
So she did. So I get after, and I went in a dumb thing. I laid down. I mean, it's a wonder. And afterwards, I got up. She dismissed the class, and I got up to get these sheets of paper with their names on them. And this one, Teresa. Hate to tell it. She had filled up 4 pages with, I hope he doesn't die. I hope he doesn't die. I thought, wow. Saw her after she left. It was from then on we had looks, because I knew how she felt. All the hell she'd given me.
That's good.
Years later. trying to think how many years that would have been. Maybe 10 or 12. I'd gone through the high school. I was at college. I'd set up a program in the prison. I was always doing something or other extra. I had to go into the prison and I think give a test or something. Anyway, I supervised reading, writing, and math classes in the prison besides that. Well, to get in the prison, you had to empty your pockets, put them in a locker, and then you could have this big key. Say, okay, you had to stand in front of this iron barred gate. Gate slid open, splang, you stepped into a room. It wasn't too different. A room about this size. And you stood there, the gate slid behind it, clang. God, what a creepy feeling that is, because you're locked in there. And then that one is supposed to slide open, clang. And you go out and you're free to go into the prison, then to the outside, carry whatever you got with you, tests or whatever there. So I'd been doing that a number of times. And I got in there one time and the gate slid behind me, clang. Waited. And I'm a little claustrophobic anyway. I don't even like elevators. And the gate didn't open.
Oh no.
And I thought, oh my. And then I hear this cackle from up in the control room. And I recognize her.
It was her?
I said, Teresa, you devil. She said, I'll never forget this. Mr. Goodman, I finally got you where I want you.
That's
I said,
wonderful.
At least you're on the right side of the bar. She said, I am, but you aren't. So we had a nice talk there. And she finally let me out to go into prison. I never saw her again, but that was so funny.
That is really, it's really nice getting to see a former student like that.
Was, I've seen, oh, I've had there, funny, I was there the second year there and I was teaching sixth grade and I had one kid that I thought at that time, and this was maybe my fourth year teaching, and I thought, if I teach for 40 years, I'll never teach a smarter kid than that. I taught for 40 years and never did teach anybody smarter than that. Unfortunately, I went to his funeral about 3 years ago. He had gone on to become a lawyer. So had his sister, who was very, very smart too. And I felt so good. He'd had a heart attack. He'd been busy with I don't know what or how many things. I felt so good. His mother remembered me and because I talked to her. But he was just one of those, no matter, you just know, this is the smartest person I'm ever gonna know, just how fast they pick things up. And he was. That was at Lindbergh School. He was with one of the classes of 36, 37. My average was 36. If you had more than 38, they did their best to try and move somebody out into somebody else's class. We didn't have that many classes, and we had teachers did have real discipline problems. A lot of them did there. There were good teachers who flat out couldn't teach. Or then you needed a steady hand, but there were also teachers who weren't worth a hoot. I had two student teachers there, and one was so good, I said, I'll recommend you for any place, even here. And they did ship there. The other one, I said, you know, you'll be a good teacher, but you can't handle this kind of stuff. So I'll write you a good recommendation, provided you promise me you will not apply for this for at least 5 years. And he said, okay, well, that's not good. And he turned out, I heard later, he was a good teacher in a different school.
That's good.
Different system. But
so your Army training definitely helped you maintain discipline.
Oh, oh, yes, it did. What the Army training did was open me up to myself. And like I say, when people say, thank you for your service, I think, no, I should thank the Army. Because I didn't learn all that stuff by belonging to the Audubon Club. And I didn't find me belonging to the Audubon Club. I didn't know I could organize things. And I did. When I was grievance chairman, they said, "Will you be at the college? Would you volunteer for grievance chairman?" I said, "Only if I can run things, and I choose my grievance." They said, "You can't do that." I said, "Then forget it." Then they came back and said, "Let's see if we can play your game." So I said, "All right, what I'm looking for, the only grievance I'll take right now is one that involves big bucks. And that when I look it over, I'm pretty sure I can win it at arbitration." They said, "We've never taken a class, a grievance to arbitration." I said, "That's what I do." So I did have a couple people come and say, "You got to take my grievance." And I said, "Nope, you just became the grievance chairman. Bye. And forget it." So I finally got it. $10,000 in a grievance. And I was real sure I could take it to arbitration. We did. And later on, I went to arbitration, they paid. Later on, I had good and bad winners and losers in the grievances. But this one, I've learned to read real closely. That's why I knew on that prisoner chase that I could get away with this because of the faulty writing that they did. I won one grievance based on one word in the table of contents. And it was worth $3,000 to a psychology instructor because the board had said there is no, it was double overload. There's no such thing as double overload. You can't file a grievance against something that doesn't exist in the contract. They said, go through the whole contract and see, no place does it use the term double overload. And I already knew what it was. I said, look at the table of contents. It says double overload, page 33. That means on 33, whatever they say is double overload. And won this guy $3,000. He bought me 2 bottles of whiskey for it. I thought it was kind of nice.
That's a good repayment. Yes. Was it good whiskey, though?
But, you know, I think it must have been. I don't remember. I really like my 40 years. I really liked teaching sixth grade, but I got this one opportunity. They came along, Bill Murray, who was the assistant superintendent. Came, I'd been teaching sixth grade there for, I don't know, 10 years, maybe. Knocking on the door. This was when Lyndon Johnson took over presidency and he opened up, he poured money in. We got bushel baskets of money in, all of a sudden when we had none before, because it was a great society. And the schools just, all of a sudden, we got all kind of programs we can do. And so 9 o'clock in the morning, I get a knock from the assistant soup. And he says, "Don, we got money enough to set up a reading program in the high school. Would you give it some thought?" I said, "Sure, Bob, let me think about it." He said, "Okay, I'll be back at 11. You tell me yes or no." He was back at 11. I hadn't any time to talk to my wife or any. I said, "Go." "Okay." He said, "Show up at the high school at like 3:30 on Wednesday and talk to Al," who had already set up a reading program like that in the junior high. So I went there and sat down to him, and we knew each other.
Yeah.
And he had these catalogs in front of him. And he said, "There they are, Don. We got an hour and a half. You got an hour and a half to spend $4,000. I said, "I've never taught a high school student in my life. I don't know what kind of stuff I ought to." He said, "We got to turn the order in now." So I went through, and I had never even seen the room that I was supposed to be assigned. That's how goofy it was under the great society. All of a sudden, bushel baskets of money in there. Spend it now. And so we did. Some of it we spent well. Some of it we didn't know what we were doing. But it was a good program I set up. And then I got the call from the college saying they are going to set up a reading, writing, and math program. Are you interested in being on the ground floor of that? I thought, God, yes, you bet I am. I am tired of it because we had learned, I'll tell you another thing, sort of thing. I'm running. I'm rambling here.
That's okay.
Anyway, I had just got assigned to the high school and to set everything up and found out that they locked the doors at noontime. And I like to go out for lunch. I didn't want to bring a sack all the time. I went to the principal and said, do I have a key to that one door? Gee, Don, I don't have any spare keys at all. He said, can't you just coordinate your coming and going with some other teacher? So I was talking to him, complaining, pissing and moaning at one of my classes, head class of like 8. Yeah. And one of my students, Mr. Goodman, you want a key to that door? I said, yeah. He said, give me 50 cents. Give him 50 cents. Next day, I had a key that opened every door in that high school, including the principal's office. This is the ghetto. This is the way you do things. By army training.
So, I'm going to go ahead and jump us back a little bit.
Sure, jump back.
Back to the army. You mentioned working, or at least being there when integration started happening and African Americans started melding into units. Was there a lot of tension, or was
no,
it just...
No, it went a whole lot smoother than you might have thought. There were a few guys... guys from the South who couldn't buy it, but our battalion commander, name was Green, Major Green, was black.
Okay.
And we had, and we made, when I went in, my first platoon sergeant, everybody was working above rank. It was Corporal Summers. And I remember him, big, tall dude. And I was kind of surprised. I don't know why. I thought, fine. No, we didn't have, and in fact, two of my good friends in the Army, this is advice for anybody that's going to be stationed anyplace, were cooks. And one's name was Slaughter. I thought, okay.
Fitting.
The other one was Makita, and they were, they were drinking buddies. But, want to go have a steak? It's after the movies. Sure. I mean, they open up the mess hall. Got to start the fire with butter and coal. See, all our stoves were coal. And then get out the steaks and fry them in butter. So, and I remember the one time I had my own room. When I was permanent party in the barracks, and it's like 6 o'clock in the morning, somebody knocks on my door, and I didn't usually show up at the orderly room until 7, knock on the door. Yeah, they open the door. There's 3 trainees. Each one has a tray full of, they had oatmeal, they had cold cereal, they had juice, they had pancakes, they had SOS, they had you name it. And I thought, yeah, one of the cooks is up for promotion. And they want me to write because I wrote all the recommendations for promotion. I never had any turned down. And that was actually the first time I had experience with creative fiction. That, in fact, it bordered on fantasy for some of those. But they all got promoted when I wrote it.
Hey, gotta be good at what you do.
There they were.
So they were just bribing you with food?
That's it. Reminded me.
Just a friendly reminder.
No, that was Slaughter. Slaughter and Makita and I hung out a lot together. I'd never had a black friend. My God. And I remember one time I was so surprised. We were out someplace or other and said, how about we go to the movie? And he said, they don't want me in that movie. I said, what? That was the first time I'd ever heard this in Missouri. He said, they won't let me in there. Okay, well, we're not going to the movies then. But it was still, segregation was still hot and heavy in the 1950s down south, not in the Army. No.
That's good.
It was absolutely, they integrated, it was only the trainees, a few trainees from someplace or other, who started this crap. Well, I'm not gonna. And you are.
One interesting thing that I just thought of, did you ever work with any Japanese or German troops?
No.
When you were training?
No, nope. Never did anything like that. But one time I remember I was in the at my desk and these people came in and they had brownish uniforms and stars, two or three stars. And holy Christmas, I never see a jump. So I jumped up and the American who was with them said they were from Thailand and they were lieutenant something or other. I said, oh, okay. They pass out there, but it went, my God, here's two or three generals coming. No, it never worked with it. We had no foreign troops. We had 250 brand new troops come in as civilians, and we taught them to do shoot and salute and polish a boot. That's what, and they were gone, and they could go. They'll find out after they left us, go into engineering basics. I liked engineering basics. I liked explosives. You show me a bridge. You show me a steel girder bridge today, and I'll tell you exactly where to place the charges and what size they ought to be, how much TNT, I don't know if you use TNT anymore, what to do, but I still have that in mind. The formula, if anybody's checking, is still P equals 3/8 A. And nobody knows what that means except old timers.
But I know.
It means pounds of TNT. The number of pounds TNT is times 3/8 of the area, the surface area. Uh-huh. And most I-beams, that for I-beams, you get the web and the, web and the something else, I forget what it is. Anyway, you measure it, and then you multiply that times 3/8. And that tells you how much TNT.
Interesting.
To cut that. So I never got to blow a bridge, but I still know how. It takes a lot of stuff.
Hey, at least you learned.
Do you want to know anything else? Since I've just been running my...
I guess we can start moving towards the end of it. We've already touched a lot on your life after the military and how it really set you up for success.
Absolutely.
Did you keep in touch with anybody from the Army?
My first sergeant, yes. And they moved to Florida. He got out before I did, of course. And he went to Florida. We went down there visiting. The wives did keep in touch by way of Christmas cards. He was a twin. He and his twin had twin cars. One was a Chrysler and the other was a DeSoto. I forget what year they were, but I remember those two cars. They had fluid drive, which meant you could shift or you didn't have to on the cars. I don't know how many years they actually did that, but we kept track of John Nelson until a few years back, and then kind of faded away. We went down to them, visit them. I'm not coming through. Someplace down in Florida. He was an engineer. We went to school together. After the Army, he had signed up to go to University of Illinois Champaign, and that's where I finished up my thing in education. And he did his engineering. And so, yeah, I went to, when we were going to Champaign, we had the one child, Brian, and I was working a full-time student. I had one job at the film library, and I had another one working for Tomaine Tom. What he did, isn't that a great name? Wouldn't you buy from him? He hired a bunch of us, and we went around to fraternity and sorority houses. We had a route. We took our own, we carried a big pot of, hot dogs, boiled hot dogs, and we had, milk cartons. We had little pies, we had sandwiches, and we had the original, I always said we had the original Subway sandwiches, but we didn't call them that. We called them Big Mothers. So, and we always said that they were made on a big loaf, Subway loaf, Big Mother. Yeah. It was so funny go into a sorority house and these three little girls, oh, I have one of those big mothers. Right. And the joke we had with that was that his name was Bill Schleicher. I still remember his name. Anyway, that Bill had the sharpest meat cutter in the world, and we advertised this thing. It had three kinds of meat and two kinds of cheese on it, which it did. But among ourselves, we said, yeah, three kinds of meat, two kinds of cheese, and you can read a newspaper through all five layers, which, yeah, it, you don't know how thin meat, bologna, and cheese can get sliced till you had a big mother.
That's funny. So it was mostly just bread?
Just the rest. Yeah. We're going to waste a lot of money on stuff. And I remember, I don't know how much that cost, but I remember Braunschweiger. It was 40-cent sandwich for Braunschweiger. And we had a number of different kinds of sandwiches. God, that thing was heavy. That was a gut buster. But in those days, I was in good shape. Came out of the Army.
Yeah, you were ready to go.
Right.
So,
go ahead.
Would you do it all over again?
Well, not that I'm 87 years old now, I think.
If you could.
Am I sorry? Oh, hell no. But I didn't get hurt. There was no time when I was close to getting hurt. And it didn't screw up my mind in any way. I learned to accept authority then, but I learned to deliver authority too, and I learned to assume authority. It was no question. Thank you for your service. Thank you for your Army.
Well, now I have a good response when people tell me thank you for my service. It can be thank you for your Navy. They're paying for my college.
There you have it. Paid for my, I finished up mine too. Yeah. Well, anything else comes to mind? Jesus, I've been talking for 2 hours.
Has it been 2 hours?
I don't know how long.
I don't think it's been quite 2 hours.
Been a long time.
Unless you have any other interesting stories you'd like to tell us about your time in the military or something to do with that afterwards.
I can't think of anything else. I'm sure. Get out in the car. Of course I'm not a hero. Well, a whole bunch of stuff. But
we could always do another interview if it comes to that. So I guess we'll wrap it up here.
Fair enough.